our songbooks, please. Turn to page number 19. We ask all of you to stand with us. Sing with the choir, "There Is a Fountain Filled with Blood." Number 19. Shall we all stand and sing together?
Good singing. That's one of Dr. Harold Seitler's favorite songs. What a tremendous song, "There Is a Fountain." We're going to the Lord in prayer this morning. One of our deacons, Brother Chester Brooks, is coming to lead our prayer. Let's pray together. Brother Chester.
What a Savior we have. Amen. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for this day. Father, we thank you for the souls that's been saved, Lord Jesus, in this year, Father. And Father, we ask, Lord, that there might be souls saved today. And Father, we thank you for all the sweet singing today, Father. We thank you for each one of our people that's come to hear the precious word today. Oh, God, bless today and bless our pastor in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Before you're seated, the ladies are going to play. The choir is coming down. What we'd like for you to do at this time is fellowship one with the other. Shake hands with those around you. Tell them it's good to see them in the house of the Lord this morning. Thank you for being at Mount Pisgah Baptist Church this morning. I appreciate you being here. I want to thank you folks for putting up with us here. We have several rows of pews and chairs in the back, and we'll get everybody in. A few places over here on the left if you need them, and thank you for putting up with the crowd. It's good to have a crowded condition, amen? And I appreciate that. Thank you so much for being here today. You can do us a favor, please, if you would, this morning, if you're visiting today for the first time. For the first time in a long time, I'd like for you to fill out a visitor's card, fill it out, put in the offering plate when it's passed you in just a minute. You can keep the ink pen. Ushers are going to stand here. Just raise your hand if you're visiting today for the first time or first time in a long time. If you'll do that for us just for a few minutes, we'd appreciate that. Some new folks with us today. Over on my left, all right, some folks visiting with us with Kathy. We're glad they're here with you today. All right, up front here, I missed this young lady all the way up front here, Barry. Come up here and let's give this young lady a card here. I miss seeing her hand. If you do that for me. Right here on the very front with Ruth this morning, or Ruby. We're grateful that she's here. If you'll fill those out, please, for us and drop in the offering plate when it's passed here in just a moment, I would appreciate it. You can tell we're doing things a little bit different this morning, and so you just bear with us, and I appreciate that. I want to say it's so good again just to see you here today. This is Family Month. About a year ago, we had one of our staff members, Elaine Weatherly, who was here at our missions conference on a Tuesday night and suffered an aneurysm and actually passed away on the way to the hospital. They brought her back to life. And we thought for a long time she would not be with us. But this morning I've asked her on this first year anniversary to share with us on Family Month a word of testimony. Elaine, if you'll come now. She's back to work. I kid her a whole bunch. Don't I, Elaine? She told me, you know what I told her, don't you? She told me the doctor said she was at 85%. I told her, that's amazing. That's 35% better than what she was when she was well.
But I love him. I do thank Pastor Walls for letting me have this opportunity to tell you how thankful I am to be here. My name is Elaine Weatherly, and I have the privilege of being this church's daycare director. Last year, on February 24th, I did become terribly ill. I was at the gym having dinner before the second night of the missions conference. And because I work with young children, my friends thought she must have a terrible ear infection. Judy and Denny Newbold drove me to the Roan Medical Center in Harriman. When we arrived at the hospital, my condition went from being terrible to critical. My heart quit beating and my breathing stopped. The staff worked quickly and my heartbeat was restored. The doctor said I'd either suffered a terrible stroke or an aneurysm. The CAT scan showed an aneurysm. An aneurysm is a weakened spot in a blood vessel that ruptures, and mine was at the base of my brain in the brain stem, and that's why we thought the pain was an earache, but it was the aneurysm leaking. LifeStar was called, and I was flown to the UT Medical Center. My parents stayed with me at the hospital till the helicopter arrived, and my brothers drove on to be there when the helicopter landed. LifeStar attendants told Keith and Alan that if I had a chance of recovery, he just drove in. Dr. William Reed was the neurosurgeon who arrived. He quickly assessed my situation, and he performed surgery in the emergency room that night to place a temporary shunt in the front of my head to remove the extra fluid that was building up. Some say I look like a unicorn that night. Dr. Reed came out with the very grim news. There was no chance of my survival, none at all. And if, by any chance, I survived 24 hours and could show some signs of intelligent life, then he would do surgery. Risky, huh? Well, God was always with me, and he allowed me to survive those first 24 hours and show signs of life. On Wednesday, less than 24 hours later, my family saw signs of consciousness and called the nurses in. I was able to squeeze my brother's hands on command and to fingerspell with sign language my brother's name. Now, I took sign language class 2 years ago, not to become an interpreter, but just to be a friend to the deaf. But God was able to use this at this time to comfort my family. The nurses, too, saw signs of my recovery, and Dr. Reed was called. He stated that they were wrong. There was no way I was recovering. They insisted, and he sent over Patty, his assistant. Patty called back with a report. She is responding. He doubted her report, and he said to her, "Patty, I may not have the power to fire those nurses today, but I have the power to fire you. Would you like to reconsider your assessment?" "Oh, no," she said. "Come quickly." Dr. Reed came and was amazed. Surgery was scheduled for the next day. He repaired that aneurysm and the damage done to my brain. The surgery had gone well, but I was not out of the danger yet. He cautioned us that for 4 weeks, I would suffer a brain seizure in that first 4 weeks, and if I did, it would kill me instantly. I spent the next 4 weeks in SCICU at the trauma center. I'm thankful to say I have no memories of that time. Isn't God good? I was then moved to the 10th floor to begin rehab, and I have only a few memories of that time. One day, I was rude to Brother Price. I have apologized. He came to visit me, and he was asking daycare questions, and he started to write down the answers. So I said, "Have you had an aneurysm? Do you need to write this down?" I did apologize. Another day, I thought, I'll tell my mother a joke. Now, we've always used humor to get us through tough times, and sometimes it's grim or gallows humor. Now, my mother was there all 53 days with me in the hospital, and I said to her, "Hey, Mom." She said, "Yes, Elaine." I thought this was a joke now. I said, "Hold that pillow over my head, and in 4 minutes, I'll be with the Lord." Oh, my mother didn't think it was a joke. So she stood up very straight and tall and got her finger out and said, "Eva Elaine Weatherly, you will recover. You will get well. Too many people have prayed for you, come to visit you, sent cards, made phone calls. You will get well." So I said, "Yes, ma'am." I did not know what I had done, but I knew it was bad. I was moved to the 10th floor and began some rehab there, and then I was moved to Patricia Neal. Patricia Neal is a fine program, but I did not like it there. I could see how bad everybody around me looked, and I didn't realize that I looked that way or worse. And they also have adult-size playpens, large enough to hold Brother Price and Pastor Walls. Now, I know you love me, and you want to know, how much time did she spend in that playpen? Not 1 minute. I was afraid to misbehave. Now, I want to tell you this last story. The very first day of rehab, the therapist said to me, Elaine, look closely at these pictures. I'm going to show you three. Tell me which one belongs on the water. There was a boat, a cat, and a basketball. I wanted so bad to say, the cat. But instantly, that picture of that playpen jumped in my mind. And so I said, the boat. I was discharged from Pat Neal in 2 weeks, and I began 2.5 months outpatient at Patricia Neal in Roane County. I truly believe that the Lord would have taken me home that night, but for the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous. I received more than 300 cards, calls, letters, prayers from everyone, and I believe that every church in Roane County prayed for me, and I say thank you very much.
I thought you'd want to hear that. I thought it'd be a blessing to you and give you some hope to keep on praying for people. It's a blessing. Ushers are going to come. Brother Jay, you come and pray for us.
Heavenly Father, as we come to you this morning, we thank you, Lord, for another time you've given us to be in your house. We just thank you, Lord, for each and every one that's come this way today. And we do thank you, Lord, especially for our visitors that are with us. We now pray, Lord, that you would just bless this offering and the tithes that be used for your honor and glory. We do pray, Father, for the many ministries of the church, and as the money goes forth, that your name would be uplifted, and we'll just give you the praise for it. We ask in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen. God bless you as you give. Glad to have with us this morning the McDonald family. Brother Jerry McDonald, I'm going to introduce him. He's going to introduce the group. And Jerry, when I baptize this morning, you'll have time to talk about your home for a few minutes and about the books as I baptize it. Well, we won't have any dead time there. So if you want to come and introduce the folks who will be singing for us this morning, we're glad you folks are here with us, our guests today. And thank you so much for being here. God bless you.
Thank you, preacher. Well, it is a joy for us to be here this morning. We're from the Calvary Boys Ranch out in Eufaula, Oklahoma. Now, let me introduce my family. They're going to be singing for you this morning. They'll be singing again tonight, and we'll have more time to talk about the work later. Miss Jan, my wife, slip up this way. Our daughter, Martha, If you would slip up this way, we've been on the road traveling about 21 years now for the Calvary Boys Ranch out in Oklahoma. My son, Jerry Jr. Jerry, come on up to help the girls here. And then his wife, Jenny, and their five girls. You girls come right on. Y'all sing for us this morning.
Taken. That's a blessing to know that our sins are gone. Gone at last. I'm so thankful that the Lord saved me and did for me what no one else could do.
We have heard the wondrous story time and time again about a land where we shall never die, where all the saints of old shall gather and live free from sin. Yonder in that city up on high, we shall live there forever. We shall live there forever. Wondrous city built by God's own hand. Kings shall tell the story, tell of His grace and glory. Come and go with me to glory land. They say the walls are jasper and the gates are made of pearl, and in that land they'll never come anigh. For with the flowing river and the stream of purest gold, Jesus Christ Himself will be the light. We shall live there forever. We shall live there forever. Wondrous city built by God's own hand. We shall sing and tell the story, tell about His grace and glory. Come and go with me to glory land. Morning brings light, it will drive all the shadows.
enjoy that? They're going to have the whole service tonight. Brother McDonald will be preaching, and they'll be singing for us. So we'll turn it over to them real early tonight, and you'll be with us at 6:30 tonight. Take your Bibles to 1 Chronicles, please. Chronicles, not Corinthians. Old Testament, 1 Chronicles, chapter 20, please. I want you to find that. And after you've found 1 Chronicles, chapter 20, I want you to turn back to your left to 1 Samuel, chapter 17. You can hold both places for me. I would appreciate it. 1 Chronicles chapter 20. I want you to find verse number 4. Before I have you to stand and we read just a couple of verses, let me ask you a question. How many of you, and I'm not trying to trick you now, but how many of you in this room this morning can name me a giant killer? How many can name me a giant killer? If you can, raise your hand if you name me a giant killer. Okay, give me his name. Okay. Can anybody else name any other giant killer? Anybody else? All right. I'm going to introduce you to some fellows this morning. I'm not sure I'll get their name right. If they were in this room, if I read this, they probably wouldn't look up this way. That's how difficult they are. But if you'll stand with me, 1 Chronicles chapter 20, please. I'm going to start reading at verse number 4. And it came to pass after this, there arose war at Gerza with the Philistines, which time Sibekai, the Hushanite, slew Sipei, that was of the children of the giants, and they were subdued. And there was war again with the Philistines, and Elhanah, the son of Jairus, slew Lapai, the brother of Goliath the Gittite, whose spear staff was like a weaver's beam. And yet again there was war at Gath. There was a man of great stature, whose fingers and toes were 24, 6 on each hand and 6 on each foot. He also was the son of the giant. But when he defiled Israel, Jonathan, the son of Shimei, David's brother, slew him. Listen to this verse. These were born unto the giant in Gath. All those we just mentioned to you, all those giants, were born to the man of Gath. And they fell by the hand of David and by the hand of his servants. They fell by the hand of David and the hand of his servants. Father, I pray in Jesus' name, let me be a blessing to these that are here. Speak to our hearts. Thank you for the services thus far. In Jesus' name with thanksgiving, amen. Be seated, please, and take your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 17. There are several things that we know or that we visited in the life of David and the many spheres of his influence. For instance, he's the sweet psalmist of Israel. We visited him on the occasion of his sinfulness. We watched him being punished by God, and we watched him repentant and coming back to God. We watch him fleeing from his son. We've seen him being restored to Jerusalem. But this morning, I'm going to look at David in a different light. And I promise you, if you'll help me get through this morning, I'll give you something that'll help you. I'm going to look at David, the raiser of giant killers. The raiser of giant killers. To see this, we've got to look at 1 Samuel chapter 17. I would give anything this morning, if I could have the time or take the time, to read to you the whole story of David and Goliath. Would you allow me just a few minutes to tell you the story? The home scene is this. David's father is back in his home, Jesse. David has been over the house of Saul and played music for him because a troubling spirit has troubled him. The Philistines have attacked the Israelites. Israel and Saul have gone to battle. David has gone back to his father's house. And look in verse 15 with me, please, and you read these words. But when David went and returned from Saul to feed his father's sheep at Bethlehem, and the Philistines drew near morning and evening and presented himself 40 days, Goliath did. And Jesse said to David, this his son, take now for thy brethren an ephod of this parched corn and these 10 loaves and run to the camp to thy brethren and carry these 10 cheeses to the captain of their thousands and look how thy brother fare and take their pledge. Now Saul and they and all of the men of Israel were in the valley of Elath fighting with the Philistines. And David rose up early in the morning and left the sheep with his keeper and took and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the trench. And as the host was going forth to battle, and they shouted for the battle. And it says, for Israel and the Philistines had put the battle in array, army against army. And David left his carriage in the hand of the keeper of the carriage. He ran to the army, and he came and he saluted his brethren. And he talked with them. There came up the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, out of the armies of the Philistines. He spake according to the same words, and David heard them. And all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, he fled from where they, because they were sore afraid. And what happens, David asked the question. David said, what will be given to the man that's going to defeat this giant? David's told what he's going to get. And then, let me tell you the story quickly now. David goes, his brother despised him for it. Said, you're nothing here. You're just here looking at something. Said, you don't need to be here. You're a little old bitty run of a fella. Said, you just go back home. And then he goes to Saul when Saul hears the news that David's volunteered to fight. And Saul tells him, you can't fight. You're just a little old bitty boy. He's a man of war from his youth. You can't go fight him either. But David says, I was with the lion and bear. I destroyed them, and I'll kill this Philistine too. They put the armor of Saul on David. David couldn't go with it. It was too big. But then David takes the armor off, goes down next to a brook, picks him up 5 smooth stones because he knew Goliath had some brothers. Amen. He was ready for all of them. Went over and the giant came out and disdained him, made fun of him in the name of his God. He said, in the name of my God, I defile you, you little old dead dog, you. And David looked at it and said, I come to you in the name of the living God. He took that sling and he slung it and he let go of the rock. It hit him in his forehead. He fell forward. And David took the sword of Goliath out of his sheath and cut his head off. And he stood there holding his head in his hand. And I'll tell you the rest of the story in just a minute. I want to preach to you about this morning how you can be a giant killer or how you can raise giants. The scenes in the valley at Elath, I stood there a few months ago. Matter of fact, I kid people about this. I said, I bought the rock from a little Jewish boy. He said that killed Goliath. I bought it from him. I didn't, but you can imagine the story. The size of the challenger of Goliath is about 9'9". He has a coat of mail that weighs 175 pounds. And on the end of the spear that he has is a 20-pound piece of metal. So you can imagine what kind of fellow he was. With him, he came the shout of the challenger. Send me out someone to fight. This is the first time in the Bible where two nations are going to decide their destiny with an individual from each nation. But this is more than a fight of a young boy over a giant. This is more than just a little thrilling story you read and tell children. It's the story of the age-old battle between righteousness and unrighteousness. It was a matter of freedom for the people of God. It was a matter of the lineage of the house of Messiah being spared. So it's an important battle that we face. But we know that the Goliath had scared people. The children of Israel were afraid. They were hiding in rocks and in caves. Because of his boisterous comments when he comes out and he says, send me out someone to fight with me. And we see his roarings without any fighting whatsoever. He has scared the people of God. And I want to tell you someone, ladies and gentlemen, is roaring on our society who tries to put fear in our heart. He's the devil. He's a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. But you and I want to raise giant killers. This is Family Month. Isn't it wonderful to see that family up here this morning? Wasn't that a blessing to see those folks here? That was a wonderful blessing. But we want to raise giant killers. I want to be a giant killer, amen? But I want to raise somebody that when I'm gone, they'll keep fighting the giants as well. And be you a parent, a Sunday school teacher, a bus worker, a nursery worker, a teacher of a Christian school or a public school, or anyone who works in any of the programs, junior churches whatsoever, if I were to ask you, would you like to raise some giants in your life, I believe 10,000 times 10,000, you'd say, yes, I would. Would you not like, after the scene has passed off and you're gone, like a Charles Kimball, they could point to you and say, he led D.L. Moody to Christ. We like to be as others, that I've influenced someone for the cause of Christ. And I want to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, everybody in this room has a potential of being a giant killer and raising giants for the glory of God. I want to tell you just a few things, basic, just simple things this morning, but I promise you, if you'll do them, they'll help you in your life. Number one, if you're going to be a giant killer, you've got to be consistent, you hear me, consistent in routine things. David, what he did, now listen to him, here's the story, I read parts of it to you. David, when it came time to play before Saul, he played before him. When Saul had gone to the battlefield, David went home and he kept his father's sheep and he worked there. So what he's doing is David is doing whatever is at hand to do. Whatever needed to be done, David said, I'll do it. Listen to me just for a second. David is the king in waiting.
He's already been anointed with the holy oil of God. He's already, the throne is his, as good as if he'd spent last night there. He's been already anointed of Samuel, the prophet of God. He's going to be the ruler of Israel. Jonathan has accepted that, the very son of Saul, who could have been in the throne room. But David, though he's anointed king, he goes back to his father. He does what needs to be done because he's willing to take care of routine things in his life. His father said to him, said, come here, David. I read to you in verse number 17. Said, come here, David. I want you to go, and I want you to go to where your brothers are, and I want you to carry some food to them. And David said, I'm willing to go. It's just a routine thing for me to do. But you know something else that David did very interesting in this text? When David went, if I read the text to you correctly in 1 Samuel 17, that he did something with his sheep. You know what he did? Before he left out those few sheep, he got someone to watch those sheep before he ever left. Because he said, those sheep are important. I'm king. I may be going to a battle. I may be on an errand for my father. But he says, still yet my sheep are important to me. And David is taking care of little detail things in his life. I want to tell you something. You're never going to be a giant killer, or you're never going to raise giant killers till you as a believer of God are going to be willing to take care of the routine things in your life. I mean, things that don't seem important. Look at 1 Samuel. Listen to me. Folks, it's important, and you might just listen, all right? It's important, routine as it may sound, for you to show up on time for Sunday school when you're teaching a class. That's routine, amen? It's important that you show up for your duties if it's routine things. It's important, just routine things will either make you or break you. Look in the Bible, very interesting, at the resume of David in 1 Samuel 16. And I'll spend a little time on this morning. I don't mean to spend a lot of time on it. 1 Samuel 16. The king has never seen David. David's never played music before him. But the king is wanting somebody to come and play music for him. And David has a resume. I want you to read David's resume in 1 Samuel 16. Look at verse number 18. Then answered one of the servants and said, behold, I have seen a son of Jesse, the Bethlehemite. Here's what he says about him. He's cunning in playing. He's a mighty valiant man. He's a man of war. He's prudent in his manners. He's a comely person, and the Lord's with him. I want to ask you a question. How did they know that about David? He had never been in the king's court. No one had ever seen him publicly. The only place David's ever been is out watching no sheep on a hillside. How would they ever know he was a cunning player? Because I want to tell you something. Before sheep or before potentates, David, when he played an instrument, he played to bring glory to God. Where anyone saw him or just the Lord heard him, he gave his best. And may I say to you, until you learn to give your best in little things, you're never going to give your best in good things, in great things. You know, everybody wants to be top dog. Nobody wants to practice. Amen? Everybody wants to be on the starting team, but no one wants to put out all their efforts like they ought to. It says that David was cunning. Wait a minute, let me just get some of this. I'll try to be brief about this. I've got too much to cover this morning. He said that he was a mighty valiant man. How'd they know that? They knew that because they had seen David, those Philistines and those people who had watched him, the men of Israel, had seen David that time when that lion came out to take one of those sheep away. And David went over and said, you'll not have that. He tore it apart. They saw him when that bear came over there, and David said, you can't have that. He took that bear with his own bare hands and he tore it apart. Said, you can't have that, that's mine. But wait a minute. He said he was a mighty man, he was a man of war. How do they know he's a man of war? They knew he was a man of war because those Philistines were hungry and they'd come to steal David's sheep. And David said, you can't have my sheep, they're mine. He defended his sheep against those Philistines because I'm going to tell you, and I have so much more there to cover this morning, I don't have time. But David said this, I'll be faithful in routine things. Now it may not seem like much for you just to show up on Sundays and Sunday nights and Wednesday night, but I'm going to tell you, you're never going to be a giant killer. Do you decide I'm going to be faithful in routine things, just consistent, reading your Bible, praying, witnessing, closet time, preparation time, all those times. Listen to me, and God has it in your life, like Paul, 3 years Arabian desert, that was God preparing him. And in your life, you'll be faithful in routine times. Second thing, if you're going to be a giant killer, if you want to raise giant killers in your life, then you've got to take the challenge of impossible things. When David brought that food to his brothers to give to them to eat, isn't it amazing that when he got there, the champion of the Philistines came out and he made that threat again, said, send me someone to fight. Listen, here's the story. When he said that, the Israelite men that were there, they went and fled and hid somewhere. And David looked around, everybody was gone.
Here's what David said. I know he said, I can read it. It's in there. It's right there in front of you. He said, that's a funny way to fight. He said, that's a funny way to do battle. He said, now what's going to be done for the guy that's going to take care of this? He said, three things. He said, three things you're going to get if you'll take care of this. He said, you're going to get rich quick. That's a good one, amen? He said, you can have Saul's daughter in marriage. That was no prize. Anytime you got to give one away, watch out. Yeah, amen. Amen. Let me get quickly to the other one before we have to talk too long here. He said, your father's house will be free in Israel. It means this. This is East Tennessee language. He said, the IRS will never call on you. Bless God, that'd be a good, wouldn't it? You free means they'll never ever pay taxes again. And here's what David said. He said, I'll go fight him. He accepted the challenge of the impossible. You may look at your relationship and say, I can't make it. Accept the challenge of the impossible. You may look at what you're facing in life and say, as they told Elaine, she was going to die. She'd never make it. She'd be what she's going to be. Accept the challenge of the impossible and say, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. All of God's people said? Amen. Here's the third thing. If you want to be a giant killer, you're going to be committed in spite of the ridicule. David arrives on the forefront where the battle is going to be raging. He said, I'll go fight. And his eldest brother, who Saul said ought to be king, Saul said, that's him. When Samuel first saw Eliab, he said, that's the one that ought to be king. And God said, that's not him. But he was the one they thought would be king. And his brother said to him, you little runt. This is East Tennessee. You little runt. Said, you just come here to be nosy. Yeah. Said, you're just checking things out. Said, you don't care. He ridiculed him. Now, I'm going to tell you something. If you want to live for God, you can always find somebody to tell you why you can't. You always find somebody that ridicule you and tell you can't do it. Now, let me tell you. I'm going to tell you. Listen, I want you to listen. You need what I'm going to tell you. When people ridicule you for living for God, you can do one or two things. You can turn and fight them, or you can fight the real enemy. If David had fought his own brother, he'd never kill Goliath. When people ridicule you about you living for God, here's the best thing you can do is what David did to that snake that bit him. I'll show you. He went. Just shake it off. Just go. Let's practice that. Look at me. Take your hand. I want you to go like this. Get this on tape, all right? Just shake it off. When people come and ridicule you, just I do. You know how many times people say to me, yeah, preacher, you can't do that. And you never do this. Shake it off. Never will forget the first guy that I worked for, assistant pastor. And I had it rough. I didn't have it made like these people do around here. I worked 54 hours a week, made $1.25 an hour, and made $25 working assistant pastor besides that. And sometimes the check bounced. Yeah. We had worked and we took a church from zero to 288 in 6 months in a tent in the cold of winter in Ohio. And I wanted to go somewhere and pastor a church. I felt like I wanted to go pastor. I just wasn't content there. And he looked at me, and that fellow did. He said, I'll tell you one thing right now, Preacher Walls, or Brother Walls. He said, you'll never make a preacher. He was right. But I shook it off. I'm just telling you, folks, when people ridicule you, you got to learn, that's it. I don't care. That's it. Yeah. Now, listen, if you ridicule me and I'm wrong, I'm going to get right with God about it. Yeah. If you try to correct me in measure and God says you're wrong about that, then I'm going to get right with God over it. But I'm not going to let your criticism stop me from doing what I do for God, and you don't need to do it either. Come on, say amen right there. Come on. Wait a minute. Somebody else ridiculed him. When David got in the presence of Saul, you know what Saul said to him? Saul said, you're just a lad. You're just a youth. Now, David had great respect for Saul. If you'll think how many times Saul tried to kill him, David had great respect for him. Someone he greatly respected, and Saul said, you'll never amount to anything. You won't be able to fight. And David said this. It's in the Greek, Hebrew. He shook it off, and he went on and fought. I'm going to tell you something. If you're ever going to be a giant killer, or you're going to raise giant killers, you're going to face some battles. But you've got to learn. You've got to shake it off. Right? Here's the fourth thing. I got two more. Fourth thing. Giant killers don't let setbacks keep them back. David has not yet got involved in the sin of Bathsheba. But those three men he raised in 1 Chronicles 20 haven't come to the scene yet either. If you'll read Uriah, that David got up. Now listen to me. Instead of laying in the mire and filth of his sin, he got up and said, "This will not keep me down." Yeah. You know, giant killers are not raised by those who've never failed. If you're looking for someone that never failed as your example, you're not going to find anybody.
Yeah.
If you're looking for someone, well, that's the perfect church, please don't join it. You'll ruin it. Come on. Oh, that's the perfect person I'd like to have. I want to tell you, it doesn't happen. But I want to tell you, you ought to have enough grace in your heart that when you fall, that you say, "I'm not going to lay in this mess. I'm going to get up, and I'm going to raise some giant killers for the glory of God." Amen? Don't lay there. Say, "I'm going to get up and go on with this." Hey, I'm your pastor. For 16 and a half years I've been your pastor. You've been a good people for me to pastor. And I've enjoyed pastoring you. But I want to tell you, it's time some of you folks here, two things you ought to quit doing. Number one, when people tell you something about somebody, two things you ought to do about it. If you have to listen to it, listen to it. But you don't have to tell it. And you don't have to believe it.
Amen.
Come on. God hadn't called you to spread garbage.
Yeah. Amen.
It's gospel, he said, spread.
Yeah.
A setback doesn't keep you back. Rise up and be a giant killer.
Yeah.
Amen. Let me tell you the next thing. Hey, this is good. Giant killers stay with the house of God. You look at David's life, all of his life. He stayed at the house of God. Now, didn't he? Come on. Listen, folks, you don't forsake the place where you get help from. There's not one person in this room, and I know almost everybody here by name, almost, with the exception of a few visitors. Some of you haven't been here for a while. I still know you by name and still pray for you. There's not a one of you that's not loved here. There's not a one of you that even know if I know things about you, it doesn't keep me from loving you and caring about you. You know why? Because you know things about me. I was preaching a funeral the other day, and a guy I hadn't seen for years. He said, "You're a preacher?" And I said, "Yes, sir, for 32 years. And there's things that maybe you could say, but I want to tell you something. This, you get help at this place, ladies and gentlemen. Don't you say, "Well, folks make the dumbest things." They say, "Well, I'm not living right now, for I'm not going to go to church." That's like saying, "I'm sick, but I'm not going to go to the doctor."
Yeah.
Right? "Well, I can't be everything I ought to be, so I'm not going to be anything." That's a garbage, folks. Get help to be what you ought to be. But David did not forsake the house of God. Listen to me. Listen to me, just quickly. Man, there's several things here. One day, David was going to church, and he got happy. Remember the story? And he got to shouting and praising God. Remember when he was bringing the ark back? And he and his wife looked out the window and said, "Boy, you made a fool of yourself." She didn't wait. And when he got home, he walked in the door, and where he's supposed to, he just had one of the greatest experiences of his life, of the joy of the presence of God. And he got home, and his wife ruined every bit of it.
Yeah.
She said, "Boy, you sure did act like the king today." But you know, his trouble at home didn't keep him from God's house.
Yeah. Amen.
Hmm? You know what David said when he fell into sin about the house of God? You know what David said? David said this in Psalm 84:10. He said, "I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in tents of wickedness for a season." Did you hear that? You know what David said when he was chastened by God? He said, "Oh Lord, how aimable are thy tabernacles. Oh God, I long for them." You know what David said about the house of God when his enemy was trying to kill him, or either when Absalom was trying to take his life? He said, "Oh Lord, as the hearth panteth after the water brooks, my soul pants for thee, oh God." He said, like a deer being run by a dog and my tongue's hanging out. And he said, "I come to the water brooks and I want to drink." And David said, "I've been chased by the hounds of hell." He said, "I've been run by my enemy." But he said, "Oh, I long for to get to the place where I can drink at the house of God again."
Yeah.
You know what David did? When God said, "No, David, you can't build the house of God," David got everything ready for his son.
because he loved God's house. You know what David did when his seven-day-old baby boy died? David, when they found out his child was dead, the Bible said David cleaned himself up and he went to the house of God to worship. And he gave us the most amazing scripture in the Bible that comforts the time of the loss of our loved ones. I see three or four families here this morning when I preached to your family's memorial service just recently. You know what David said? David said, I cannot bring the child to me, but I can go to him. Giant killers just stay with the house of God. Then giant killers, lastly, learn to lean upon the Lord. Boy, David went out and said, I have no confidence in this flesh to fight you. But he said, the living God's going to give me the victory over you. He said, God's going to let me whip you. I want to tell you something, folks. I have no confidence in my ability. But I want to tell you, the power of God and the word of God sure does make a good change in people's lives. Amen. As far as for me and my house, as they sung, I'm going to serve the Lord. David sings the song, same song everywhere he goes. When he goes to fight, play with Saul, he plays the music. It depends on God. When he fights the enemy, he's playing the music of our dependent upon God. He said, I cannot go with this armor, but I can go in the name of the Lord Jesus and the power of God. Amen. So with a staff, five smooth stones, a shepherd bag, a slinging God, David goes out. You've got to laugh with me just for a few minutes about this. Here's this big old 9'9" giant, 175 pounds of coat of mail, and a 20-pound weaver's beam heavy instrument on the end of his spear. And he comes up to David. And David says, I curse you. He says to David, I curse you in the name of my God. I know David, I believe this, just snickered inside of himself. You know why he snickered? Now listen to me. I'm going to tell you why he snickered. Because he knew what God, Goliath, was talking about. He was talking about the God of the Philistines called Dagon. You know what happened to Dagon in 1 Samuel chapter 4? When they set the Ark of the Covenant in the presence of Dagon and they left it overnight, Dagon fell down and the next morning they had to come pick their God up. They set their God up and the next night he fell down but he lost his arms. They had to set their God back up. David said... He said, that God you had to pick up, I'm supposed to be afraid of? I'm glad my God picks me up, amen. Pick my God up. Giant killers want to glorify God. You talk about a battle, folks. This was the battle. Because I want to tell you, had David not prevailed, listen to me just for a second, I'm closing. The promised line of Messiah would have not been accomplished. Because David was not married and had a son as of yet. Redemption's plan would have been stymied. But I want to tell you, the son of David, David himself, gives victory. And he lives. And I want to tell you, had Christ, the son of David, through the lineage of David, not prevailed over death, hell, and the day, and the day did make a difference. When the Son of God arose, we'd never have victory in our lives. But thank God, he arose, he arose, he arose. Well, let me tell you one last thing. Champions make a difference. Giant killers make a difference. Here's what happened. Here's the rest of the story. I'm going to tell you, I'm through. David goes over as a teenager, down by that brook, picks him up five stones. Walks toward that giant, takes that sling, it's like two pieces of string with a little bitty pouch in the middle, and you sling it underhanded. I didn't know that was in it. And he lets go of one end and that rock hits him, kills him. He falls down, he cuts his head off. You know what happens? Is all those Israelites been hiding in the caves? You know what happened to them all of a sudden? They got real brave. Because when Israel, when the Philistines started running, they came out and said, let's go get them. Because God gives victory to his people. Let's go get them. I know I've told this story too many times, but I won't tell it again because I like it. I'll never forget the day I was sitting in my office and I was looking out and some kids were playing softball out on a gravel area all the area of the infield was gravel, so it just, you never could catch a ball. It'd catch you most of the time, if you know what I mean. All it would bounce around. Little old bitty boy was playing third base. Little old bitty fella, just a little running fella standing over playing. His mind was 30,000 miles away. He's standing over that little glove, holding it down like this, and a guy's batting, and the guy hits a line drive right at him. And would you believe it? It stuck in his glove. The boy didn't move an inch. He said, "Oh!" He said, "Let's play ball." He's ready. And may I say to you, you raise your family, be faithful things of God, witness on the job. You got giants you face. God wants to give you the victory, and we want to be giant killers. It said something of David I didn't cover a while ago in 1 Samuel 16:18. It says that David knew the Lord. The Lord was with him. You're never going to be a giant killer till you know that you know the Lord. And you know him in the free pardon of sin. Man, there's so much. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. David took his trophies and put them in the house of God, because David wanted to make sure that all the praise went to God. He used those trophies later in another battle, because every battle you face, it, God gives you victory. You can win other battles with it. And I pray we'd do so. Father, I want to thank you. Please speak to our hearts. Use us for Christ's sake, I pray. Have me quickly now raise a hand and say, "Pastor, I'm glad I know the Lord. I'm grateful that I know Jesus lives in my heart." Would you raise your hand up high just for a second? You know that you're saved. Boy, it's good to be saved, isn't it? It's good to have the giant killer on our side, amen? And we won the victories of the Lord Jesus. I'm grateful for that. Let me ask you just a few questions, then we'll give an invitation this morning. Are you taking care of the routine things of your life? Those things that God just told you to, are you doing those things? Are you finding at hand what needs to be done doing it? Let me ask you this morning, are you taking the challenge, the impossible things in your life? Are you looking at him and say, "Man, God can handle those things together"? How you handle criticism in your life? How about the house of God? Do you know the Lord? First of all, I want to tell you, everybody faces battle, folks. But I want to tell you, we have the victory through the Lord Jesus Christ. Have me quickly now raise your hand and say, "Pastor, I know I'm saved, but I'm facing some battles in my life. And I just need you to pray for me. I'm going through some hard times right now. Would you pray for me?" Would you raise your hand where I can see it just for a second? God bless you. Several folks across this room. And I want to assure you that God wants to help you. And God wants to encourage you. And God wants to strengthen you. How many people quickly raise hands and say, "Pastor, I know I've been saved, but I know I've not been living where God wants me to live as a Christian. I've not been in the battle where I ought to be as a child of God. And Pastor, would you pray for me? Would you put your hand up where I can see it?" Right back down. God bless you. God bless you. Yes, other folks. May God help you. May God encourage you to do right this morning. You ought to come, you ought to do right. You ought to get back in the battle of killing giants this morning. Ask God to help you. Now, there's some folks in this room, you couldn't raise your hand. You know you're saved. Some of you have children you ought to pray for this morning. Ask God to give you strength to raise them for God. I want you to come this morning and ask God. No one's looking around. Our heads are about, our eyes are closed. Would you please, right now, as we stand quietly while they're playing for us, if you need to slip out of your seat and come for any reason this morning, if you need to come and be saved, I want you to come. You need to come and pray for your family, or ask God to get you back in the battle, or do some things you need to do, I want you to come while we're waiting. I'm not going to keep you along. If you need to come, you slip out of your seat and you come while they're playing for us right now. Slip out of your seat. You come on. While others are coming, you slip out of your seat and you come on now. You talk with God about something in your heart and your life. Others are coming. Slip out of your seat and you come on right now while we're waiting just a moment. I'm going to keep you long. If you need to do that, I want you to come. You come on while we're waiting just a second. Something in your heart you need to talk with God about. Then everybody in this room could raise a hand. You know you're saved. Then everyone could put your hand up and say, "Pastor, I know the Lord Jesus Christ lives in my heart." You don't know that, but you'd like to know that this hour. I want every child of God in this room. I want every child of God. I want you to pray. I want every child of God. I want you to start praying. I want you to ask God to have his way. Ask God to have his way in your heart and in your life. And ask God to have his way in the lives of others that are here. But I want you to come. I want you to come. You need to pray about something in your heart and your life. Other folks are coming. I want you to come. Would you come, please, while we're waiting? Let's sing a verse, Brother Harvey. Let's sing a verse. You come on.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. Yes, and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me? Why should we linger and heed not his mercies? Mercies for you and for me.
While our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed just for a second. If you're here and you're lost without Christ, you are to get saved. No reason for you to leave. Jesus took your place, fought your battle at Calvary for you, wants to save you by his grace. And I promise if you'll come, I promise he'll save you this hour. You need to come, you come. We're waiting for you to come. If you're here and you've been saved somewhere else, but you've never made public at a church service what Christ has done for you, I want you to make it public this morning. If you're here this morning, this is the church that you feel like you want to be a part of this church family and be a part of what we're trying to do here, I want you to come this morning. Would you do that, please? If you're going to get baptized this morning, I want you to come. Any other reason you need to come? While they're playing another verse for us, please look out of your seat and you come right now while we're waiting. Come on. Just take this opportunity. What you need to do. Waiting just a second. You can come on. You can come on. Others are coming. We're waiting on you to come. Just look out of your seat and come on this morning. Let's take care of that, all right? You need to do it. You come on now. Talk with God about something. You come on. Get something set in your heart and your life. You come on this morning. Church family ought to be a part of. You need to get baptized this morning. You make public you've been saved. Talk with God about something. One more verse. Let's sing one more verse, Brother Harvey. One more verse. This is your verse. Do something about it.
Oh, for the wonderful love he has promised.
Come on.
Promise for you and
you come on, we're waiting.
Though we have sinned, he has mercy and pardon.
You come on, come on.
Pardon for you and for me. Come home.
Come on. We've talked about it. You ought to get it settled. Come on.
Home, ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home.
All right, if you'll be seated just for a moment, please. Just mention a few things, too. We're going to baptize a couple of people, three people this morning. We have one to be baptized tonight. Had a family I led to Christ, and they were going to get baptized this morning. They came by to see me this morning on the way to the hospital. You pray for the Ralston family. We have Jonathan David, and I won't say that because of David I preached about this morning, and said he hadn't been killing the giants and some things in his life. He's got those things straightened up with God. I'm glad for that. We're dedicating his life to the Lord, and we're going to kill some giants together. Amen. And I'm happy for that. You know I love you, and I appreciate that. All right, Brother McDonald, why don't you come and tell about your home for a few minutes, and I'll get ready to baptize and tell about your books or tapes, and then we'll let your family get back there by the book table as well. All right.
Well, that was a good message, amen. Appreciate that this morning. We've been at the Calvary Boys Ranch for 21 years this past September. I pastored about 11 years before we went into the ministry there. God led us to start a home for boys and down near Eufaula, Oklahoma. It's kind of down in the eastern part of the state of Oklahoma. And as I said, we've been there for 21 years. We've seen hundreds of boys come through the ministry over these years. We've never taken any state funds. We would like to keep the state's rules and regulations out if we possibly can. We believe ours are much supreme to theirs because we go by the Word of God. And we've seen lots of results, and I'm aware of the fact they don't see too much result in these years with the young men. We take boys 7th grade and up. And when I say up, I really mean up, because we not only do we have the academy boys through high school, we also have a program for men 18 and older. And in that program, we've had men as old as 58 years old. I talked to us this morning about your husbands. If we have room, we might take some of them home with us. As in the younger boys have been a blessing over the years to see him work. And we've been in the ministry so many years. We used to travel years ago with boys a lot. We very seldom do that anymore for several reasons. But anyway, we have been in the ministry so many years now. It seemed like just about every place we go around the country, we run onto some of the boys that have been in the program from time to time, because we've had boys from all over the United States there in the program. And what a blessing it is to run on to young men now who are young men and have wives and children, and come up to us in churches and say, "Boy, I bet you don't remember me," and usually I don't. But then they tell me their name and share with me that they were at the ranch so many years ago. But we're grateful for that. We're grateful for what God is doing there. We've seen so many marvelous things. I tell you, it's been such a blessing to see the results of what God can do. And then in the older program in 1990, we started the program for the older men. We've seen lots of lives put back together. And that's been a tremendous blessing. Many men who have been separated from their wives and because of drugs and other reasons, and now after finding Christ as their Savior, the wives accepting them back home, homes put back together, some in the ministry now serving the Lord, and that's a tremendous blessing. I tell you, God's good, isn't he? Amen. And we know he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. And we'd appreciate your prayers, and I trust that you'll pray for us and remember the Calvary Boys Ranch and in your prayers, and that we'll continue for many years salvaging the lives of boys. We have several shops. I don't know how much time we have. You ready to preach here? All right. And I'll share some more with you about the ministry. I'm sure all of you will be here tonight, surely. Amen? Well, most of you. All right. Amen.
It's Ruby.
Yes, sir.
Ruby rides our bus and comes to church every service.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God.
She had been saved some years ago, wasn't satisfied with her baptism, but I'm glad she's getting baptized this morning.
Sir.
Ruby, we tell you, we love you, Ruby.
Yes, sir. I love you.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to baptize you, or do my best.
Yes, sir.
In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism. Risen to walk in some life. I got you.
Okay? Glory! Glory! Hallelujah!
Amen.
Praise God! Praise the Lord!
Amen. Nothing wrong with that. Just don't drown a preacher like that.
Praise the Lord!
Amen. 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 That's right. This is Amy Bonifacius. I want her family and friends that have come to see her get baptized this morning. I want you to stand. Her family and grandparents, thing. Just stand up for a second, if you would. And we're grateful you're here today.
Amen.
Thank you for coming. Amy, you can be seated. Amy got saved last Sunday night. After the services, we had called her home to check on something else, and she'd been under conviction. My wife had a chance to lead to the Lord over the phone. I'm glad she got saved. Her grandparents are here also this morning, and Elmer and Melvaline. We love them. Love this family. I appreciate them. Amy, I'm proud of you. You know that, don't you? Tell you, I love you. And I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism. Amen. Risen to walk. Amen. Amen. Good job, buddy. God bless you. That's precious. All right. This is Travis Williams. Travis waited around last Sunday night to church under conviction and got saved in my office. Amen. I'm glad for that. Amen. I want the boys on the Auburn Springs basketball team. I want you all to stand. The boys are here this morning. I want you to stand up, boys. Those boys, my church, and all of these boys won the district game? Made all district. And their basketball team, they won their district, and I'm glad for that, aren't you?
Amen.
Travis was voted the most valuable player. I'm proud of any young man. He's on visitation every Saturday. He comes, and I'm thankful for that. I'm proud of him. Proud of our young people.
Amen.
Woo! Amen. Amen. I mean that. Amen. Praise God for young people. They're a blessing to us.
Yes, sir.
Some of the families here to see you are today. I believe have his family stand for a second, and we'll baptize him. All right, that's your father. Danny, all right, God bless you. Tell you we love y'all. Travis, I baptize you. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Married to Christ in baptism. Blessed to walk in the good job, brother. Amen. All right, Brother Harvey, take some prayer requests, and I'll be right out.
When you see the Lord bless us like this, He is certainly good. I know what Sister Ruby was shouting about. We have some folks in the hospital we want you to remember in prayer. We have George Bullock, Gail Chester, and Pearl West. Pearl's near going home to be with the Lord. Please pray for her family and ask the Lord to help her to have a happy ending here, to enter to a new life with Him. Also, we want to continue praying for Bill Carr, Brother Carr's father, and A.Y. Davis in Fort Sanders Hospital. Also, keep praying for the Adkins family who buried their loved one. Sister Adkins has health problems. Gene Wilson, dialysis 3 times a week. Carolyn Rayburn, we want to remember these folks in prayer. And you may have someone that you would like to mention especially. Yes, over here. Well, yes, the Garrett family that lost a little child in an automobile accident a little over a week ago, buried last Sunday. And anyone else? Brother Benny. Mabel Davis, this is Buddy Davis' sister-in-law, had aneurysm, I believe, and so you remember her in prayer. Yes, Brother Nation. Okay, so person with surgery, blockage, having surgery this week. Yes, yeah. Okay, Marie Schubert, remember that request? Had an automobile accident? Yes, Charlene. Unspoken request? Well, there's Sister Adkins here this morning. I didn't even realize she was here, so you keep praying for her. Yes. All right. Okay, remember that request? Vicki, Delana Harvey's doing fair, but continue praying for her. Yes. Elizabeth, who? Eddie, okay, in the hospital. Any other requests?
Marty Foster over here.
Marty Foster, okay. Oh, okay. Okay, that request. Preacher, you want to?
It's good to see Linda Mark here today. Just her father just went home to be with the Lord just a day or so after Clyde did. Good to see them as well. Also, I meant to mention the boy's name, Chris White. Stand up. When you stood up a while ago, Chris, and also Craig Price. I should have mentioned those boys' names. Stand up, Craig. Folks know who you are, but stand up anyway. Thank you, fellas. I meant to mention your name a while ago. Let's pray together. You may have an unspoken request. I do. I've got things I need from God. Brother Harvey, I want you to come back up here, and I want you to pray for us this morning, all right?
Father, as we come before you again, Lord, with these requests, these special requests here today, we pray that thou would not only hear but answer, Lord, according to your riches,
yes,
and your knowledge and glory. Father, there were many requests that was not mentioned openly that we have heard even in our classes this morning. We pray that thou would meet every one of these. And for these who are baptized today, we pray that thou would strengthen them,
yes,
and help them to grow and prosper in the things of God. Father, that we may together honor thee in our feeble laborings that we put forth in this world, Lord, to present to thee, that it might be for the upbuilding of your kingdom. Father, I pray now for everything that's been done. Pray for our visitors, for the singers today. Give them a good time with us. And Father, may they be blessed by being here, and we have been blessed by them being with
yes.
us.
Yes.
We pray for our preacher, for all that's done, for those who have spoken to others about coming to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Meet every need we have for Christ's sake. Amen.
Amen. I'm going to have your attention just for a second now. McDonald's, I want you all to step out by your tables if you need to. He has all kinds of books and tapes. You ought to look at them. Books, a great price. You'll buy them cheaper. They're good. They're good books. They're reprints. Most of them are. They're good. You ought to check those out in tapes. Okay, if you all will go ahead and whoever's going to slip back that way, I'll let you do that. Also, Vicki Maddox. Is Vicki here? If you are, stand up. Where is she? I saw her somewhere. You made all tournament team, right? And thank you. Didn't mean to overlook you. All right. Any of the families that want to come here and sit with these whom we're baptized this morning.